Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Friends of the Columbia Gorge's webinar, Pika-ture Perfect Comeback. We are thrilled to kick off spring with a webinar focusing on the gorgeous unofficial mascot, the pika. Thank you all so much for attending this evening as we crawl into the world of pika post Eagle Creek fire with two experts in the field. While you're getting settled and wait for a few more to join us, I wanted to go over some Zoom housekeeping before we get started. If you're new to Zoom webinars, I'm going to run through a few things to quickly familiarize you. You'll notice your microphone is muted, and that is because with so many of us here together, it's best to give everyone the best chance to hear the speakers without each other's background noise. Your cameras are also turned off so we can pay full attention to the speakers. Live captioning is available for this meeting. Simply click on the caption button located on the black toolbar to enable it. Throughout this webinar, there are two ways to interact with us, either through the Q&A or the chat box. We will hold all questions until the end of the webinar to ensure we have enough time to get through everything. After the last speaker, we'll go straight into Q&A for about 15 to 20 minutes, facilitated by me. If you have a question for our speakers, please type it into the Q&A box toolbar on the bottom of your computer, tablet, or phone screen. If you're using a tablet or phone, the toolbar will likely be at the bottom of the Zoom window on your screen, but it may also be on the top, depending on your device. If you don't see the toolbar, try moving your mouse toward the bottom of the screen or touch your screen and it should come up. We will do our best with the limited time we have to get through all of your questions at the end. This webinar is being recorded and the video will be uploaded to Friends' YouTube channel tomorrow. If you want to go back and watch some of our previous gorgeous wildlife webinars or enjoy this presentation so much you want to go back and watch again later or share with your friends, then please check out our webinar playlist at gorgefriends.org/webinars. While you're there, subscribe to our YouTube channel so you can stay up to date with our latest videos. All right, so that wraps up the Zoom housekeeping. Again, I want to thank you for joining us tonight as we celebrate pika in the gorge and learn about their comeback after the 2017 Eagle Creek fire. Did you know that in the Columbia Gorge, pika live at a much lower elevation than populations anywhere else in the world? Tonight we will learn from Johanna as she talks about her research on pika in the gorge and hear from Carrie how the citizen science program, Cascades Pika Watch, has been successful on the long-term monitoring of these wonderful creatures. My name is Kenzie Hammond, and I'm your host for tonight. I am the Youth and Community Education Specialist here at Friends of the Columbia Gorge. Our presenters for the night are Dr. Johanna Varner and Carrie Springer. Our first speaker tonight is Dr. Johanna Varner, aka Pika Joe. She is a pika biologist who lives in Colorado. During the academic year, she teaches biology at Colorado Mesa University. But during the summer, she spends a lot of time in the mountains looking for pika. That work involves placing temperature sensors and collecting scat samples to analyze for stress. In graduate school, Joe spent 5 years tracking pika in the Columbia Gorge and Mount Hood, camping in the rain and learning about how this incredibly unique population survives in this unusual habitat. She also was a founding member of the Cascades Pika Watch program, which has invited gorgeous residents and visitors to monitor pika for the last 13 years. Before she was a pika biologist, Joe was a biomedical engineer, baker, and a blueberry farmer. But she likes studying pika best because they are so cute and they live in beautiful places. Our second speaker is Carrie Springer. She grew up in upstate New York and spent 5 years in North Carolina, where she met her wife, Tracy. They were excited about the greenery and mountains of Washington and Oregon and relocated here in 2007. Eager to immerse themselves in the outdoor culture of the Pacific Northwest, Carrie has always found reasons to walk in the woods and listen to and look for wildlife. Sometimes she'd get lucky and capture them with her camera. She was on the Waukena Trail in 2015 and amazed at the sight of a potato-sized pika steadfastly collecting food. Seeking more information on this tiny creature she'd never seen before, she stumbled upon Cascades Pika Watch, and she and Tracy joined as eager volunteers. After years in the program documenting the pika's population recovery in the gorge after the 2017 Eagle Creek fire, she took on the role of volunteer coordinator for the project in 2023. Before I pass the virtual microphone to Johanna, I wanted to talk a little bit about Friends if you are new to our event. Friends of the Columbia Gorge is the only conservation group entirely dedicated to protecting, preserving, and stewarding the gorge. Friends led the fight to protect the gorge by helping create the Columbia River Gorge National Scenic Area over 40 years ago, and has been working hard ever since to safeguard the gorge and make sure the natural wonders found today will be preserved for future generations to come. Friends is entirely dedicated to protecting and enhancing the natural, scenic, cultural, and recreational resources in the gorge. And now, Johanna, please take it away.
All right, let me get my screen shared here. Does that look okay, Kenzie?
Yes, it looks great.
Okay, great. Well, thank you all so much for coming, and thank you, Kenzie, for the introduction. I'm really honored to have been invited to speak with you tonight about pikas, and I'm really excited to tell you some stories about pika research that's going on in the gorge, as well as the amazing work that is being done by the Cascades Pika Watch program. And then Carrie is going to take over the last bit of today's talk to tell you a little bit more about how you could get involved and the work that will be happening this summer. Before we get started, though, I want to give a quick shout out to these three folks, Shervin Hess at the Oregon Zoo, Amanda Greenvoss, and Steve Clark of Clark College, and of course to the Oregon Zoo as well for supporting and housing the Cascades Pika Watch program. Without their work and without the support of the zoo, none of this would have happened and we wouldn't be here talking with you today. Carrie is obviously also super instrumental, and you'll see that when you hear from her next. Okay, so we're all here tonight, and you guys are all part of and follow this organization because the Columbia River Gorge is a very special place. And as a biologist, I also came to love the Columbia Gorge because of its unique natural history and rich biological diversity. Now, some of this biological diversity is due to the number of ecological niches that are created by its extremes. And as you probably know, the annual precipitation in the gorge drops from somewhere around 75 inches on the upper slopes of the West Cascades down to 10 to 15 inches near the Dalles. And I think that there's maybe nowhere else on Earth that this rain shadow effect can be seen so dramatically, which you can see here in this satellite image of the area. Now, this kind of special habitat also makes home for special species, and another very special inhabitant of the Columbia River Gorge is the pika. And of course, that's what you came here to hear about. So this is a little bit of an outline of our talk tonight. We're going to start by telling you a little bit more about the natural history of pikas and why they're sensitive to environmental changes in some contexts. Next, I'm going to tell you a few stories about how pikas are able to make a living in the Columbia River Gorge. And finally, I'll tell you a little bit about the science emerging from the Cascades Pika Watch Project. And then Carrie will tell you a little bit more about how you can get involved and the work that's going to happen this summer. All right, so let's get started. American pikas are small mammals in the lagomorph order, which means that they're related to rabbits and hares. And they're about the size and shape of a russet potato. Also, in a very recent, very scientific survey, they were voted the cutest mammals. So there you have it. You heard it here. It's science fact now. And interestingly, pikas are the only lagomorph to call. And so I want to play for you a little video of what they sound like. Okay, hopefully you all enjoyed that. I'm sorry, I wish that I could take credit for this amazing video, but I had nothing to do with it. It was making the rounds on the internet a couple of years ago, but I like to use it in talks now. But seriously, it is true that pikas are the only lagomorphs to call, and they are actually really very cute. Right, that is a real pika call. So pikas have a restricted distribution to high elevation talus. And you're going to hear this word a lot tonight, talus, which just means rock slides and boulder fields. And pikas live across Western North America, at least this species. And this distribution is thought to be limited by both a sensitivity to high temperatures and a limited ability to disperse between patches of habitat. Now, unlike most alpine mammals, pikas actually can't hibernate during the winter, and there's not a lot of food available when most of their habitat is under snow. And so most pikas actually spend much of their summer amassing a food cache, which then will sustain them throughout the winter. A single pika can actually collect up to about 65 pounds of food, or 28 kilograms. And remember that pikas are about the size and shape of a potato. So building these caches means a tremendous investment in summer activity. Of over 13,000 hay trips to the meadow and back. And in each bout, they're carrying quite a lot of food compared to their body size. So for context, if we were to scale this up to human size, it basically would be like us amassing somewhere around 5,000 pounds of food, making all of those trips to the grocery store, 13,000 trips, and carrying home the equivalent of 4 heads of lettuce in your mouth. So the next time you're at the grocery store, I invite you to investigate the potatoes and then take a look at the heads of lettuce and imagining carrying 4 of them home in your mouth over 13,000 times during the summer. And I think that that will give you a good feel or intuitive feel for how much work it is for these animals to survive each year. Now, recently, pikas have garnered some attention and kind of a reputation for being sensitive in response to climate change. And that's largely as a result of some of the resurvey efforts that have occurred in parts of their range, and especially in the Great Basin. So this map is showing the results of resurveys of locations where there was a historical record of pikas about 100 years ago. So each dot represents a site where we have a historical record that's usually in a museum specimen or some other way that we can verify for sure that pikas were there from the early 1900s. And what you can see in this map is that now, when the sites were resurveyed in the early 2010s, about 40% of the locations, all of the locations represented by the orange dots, have gone locally extinct. And these extinct sites tended to have warmer summers and a reduced winter snowpack, which supports some of the leading hypotheses about how climate might affect pika. So first off, if the temperatures get too high, the pikas won't just, they're sensitive to heat, but they won't just like run around until they're overheated and then like die, right? In the same way that if the temperatures get too hot during the summer, none of us would just sort of run around until we died of heat exhaustion. Instead, we would take refuge in an air-conditioned building or a cooler refuge. And that's what the pikas do as well. However, if they're unable to forage during those warm summers because they're restricting their activity in cooler spaces, they might not get enough food. And this could also be compounded by the fact that the winter snowpack actually insulates against harsh winter temperatures. So when you have a thick layer of snowpack, it usually acts like a blanket that helps to insulate the ground. And if you measure the temperature in deep snowpack, as you may have done if you're interested in things like snow stability, you'll find that the temperatures at the bottom of the snowpack are consistently quite right at 0 degrees Celsius or 32 degrees Fahrenheit. And then the temperature gets colder as you get to the surface. So ironically, the loss of winter snowpack may actually result in colder winter temperatures in the rock slides and boulder fields where the pikas live. All right. So given these constraints, we typically find pikas in places that look like this. And this is a picture that I took near the timberline on of Mount Hood. But in sort of the Cascades, you find this kind of habitat near timberline in the Cascade volcanoes. And what you'll see in this picture is that we've got some extensive talus patches, and there's a large perimeter of alpine meadow vegetation as an ample food resource. However, pikas also survive in some seemingly unsuitable habitats, including, of course, the Columbia River Gorge. Now, the gorge is basically predicted to be unsuitable for pikas based on what we know about their requirements for temperature and snowpack. The summers are quite long. There's little to no persistent snowpack, and there's frequent freezing rain and ice storms during the winter that would expose these animals to inclement weather. And just to drive home sort of how special and unique this population is, this is a map that shows you the minimum elevation at which pikas are found across their range. Now, the yellow and orange areas indicate increasing elevations until the red areas, which is what indicates basically unsuitable habitat. And so what you can see here is that basically the elevation at which we find pikas increases as you go south and east in the continental United States. So they're found in much higher elevations here where I live in Southwest Colorado compared to where many of you are in the Pacific Northwest. But what you may have noticed by now is that this dark blue spot right here in the center is the Columbia River Gorge. So the Columbia River Gorge is literally the epicenter of the elevational distribution of this species. It's the only place that we find pikas at this low of elevation. Okay. So when I started my PhD program in 2010, we really knew very little about this population. There were literally two papers that had been published about this population that both basically said, hey folks, pikas live here in the Columbia Gorge. We don't really know how. When I arrived for my first season of fieldwork in 2011, which is now kind of a long time ago, what we found is that the section of the Columbia Gorge where we find pikas is characterized by this lush Douglas fir forest that's punctuated by talus slopes that were home to pikas. And one of the most notable features of this habitat to me that struck me like right from the beginning was this thick layer of moss. And the blanket of moss can be somewhere around 6 to 15 inches thick in some places, and actually serves as the substrate for grasses, ferns, and flowers to grow right on the talus. And so a big central question of my work at the time was trying to understand how pikas survive in this atypical habitat. So I set out with a small army of undergraduate students, and together we collected over 400 hours of behavioral observations of pikas. We also placed out a network of temperature sensors to record the temperatures that the pikas actually experienced. And we placed sensors basically right at the surface below the moss cover, and then also about a meter down or a couple of feet down below the surface of the talus. And one of the most interesting things that we discovered was that pikas in the gorge had a really unique diet. So about 60% of the diet of pikas at two sites that we watched them at the gorge was actually made up of moss. And in contrast, the typical food resources of grasses and flowers represented less than 30% of their diet at both sites. Now, this was super interesting because basically from a like diet perspective of mammals, nobody eats moss. It's like the nutritional equivalent of eating a cardboard box. But this moss is available year round, and they're basically living in a hay pile that remains throughout the winter and doesn't require any extra effort during the summer to harvest. So to follow up on this observation, we were really interested in like how pikas were able to eat this moss and get a lot of nutritional requirements out of it. And there's a growing body of literature suggesting that gut microbes could be really important to what plants herbivores can feed on. And so we collected scat samples to be able to analyze gut microbes. And in the lab, we extracted DNA and sequenced the DNA to identify bacterial strains. And there was one strain of bacteria that turned out to be very interesting, which is a group of bacteria that's called melanobacteria. Now, what you'll see in this graph here is on the y-axis, the percent of the microbiome that's made up of melanobacteria. And we broke up our samples in Oregon from the Columbia River Gorge based on whether pikas were at sites where they were consuming a large amount of moss or where there wasn't nearly as much moss available and the pikas were going to be feeding on more typical resources. And then we compared the percent melanobacteria to pikas from other states and to other herbivores that we were able to find this information in the literature. And what we found here is that this strain of bacteria, this genus of bacteria, is super enriched in the moss feeding pikas. They have over 5 times the concentration of melanobacteria compared to pikas at other states, and nearly 30 times more melanobacteria compared to other herbivores that have been reported in the literature. Now, unfortunately, this is a strain of bacteria that can't be cultured, but it has been implicated before in mammalian herbivores' ability to ferment fiber, right? Which we actually don't produce the enzymes to be able to digest ourselves. Only bacteria can break up those bonds that hold the carbon molecules of fiber together. And this result really suggested to us that these gut microbes may be giving the gorge pikas a special superpower of being able to get enough nutrients and energy out of the moss that they eat. Another kind of surprising observation that we made during this time was that pikas in the gorge construct smaller hay piles than anywhere else in their range, if they even bother to construct hay piles at all. So actually only about 1 in 4 animals even makes a hay pile. And when they do, we found that they're less than 20% the mass of their high elevation counterparts on Mount Hood. Finally, we also looked at the temperatures in the rock slides where the pikas live. So what you're looking at here is a time trace of temperatures. And this yellow line represents the ambient temperature. The y-axis is in Celsius here. And for context, about 15 degrees Celsius is about 60 degrees Fahrenheit overnight. And the highs during this period of time, during 2012, of about 35 degrees Celsius is over 90 degrees Fahrenheit. And so this is basically the temperature that you or I would experience walking around at the surface of the talus as humans above the talus. But when we looked at the temperatures that exist below the talus, the ones that pikas actually are experiencing, what we found is that there's an extremely cool and very stable subtalus microhabitat about a meter below the surface. So this blue line represents the temperatures measured during the same period of time down in the talus, and it was about 7 degrees Celsius, which is about 45 degrees Fahrenheit. So the daily fluctuations in this microhabitat, you can see it looks like a pretty straight line because the temperature doesn't fluctuate more than about 0.2 degrees Celsius. And we see these instantaneous disparities with the ambient temperature that could be up to 31.5 degrees Celsius. So to put this in perspective, this is basically like being in a refrigerator when it's 90 degrees outside. It's also among some of the largest temperature disparities ever measured, and actually provides more insulation even than what we see in a lot of burrowing systems. So to sum up how our previous findings about how pikas are persisting in the Columbia River Gorge, at least before the fire, and don't worry, I'm going to talk about that next. They definitely seem to consume an unusual food resource, and this is sort of largely a behavioral adaptation, but it may be enabled by those special gut microbes. And eating moss also seems to release them from making large hay piles, since it's available all winter and requires no energy to harvest. In addition, we're finding that pikas are able to avoid the hottest parts of the day and the year by seeking refuge in favorable microclimates. And importantly, they can afford this since their winter survival doesn't depend as strongly on a food cache. Okay, so here I'm going to switch gears a little bit and tell you a little bit about the Cascades Pika Watch program, how it started, and how it's helped us understand this very special population of pikas following the Eagle Creek fire. So when I started working in Oregon, I got linked in with a big group interested in pikas in the gorge and citizen science, which was led by David Shepherdson at the Oregon Zoo. So I was there actually when this project kind of came together in 2011. And Cascades Pika Watch really started as this huge collaboration between scientists, educators, land managers, and conservationists. But it was housed at the Oregon Zoo. And we basically spent our first 5 years or so engaging volunteers in doing some sitting surveys at a variety of sites, where basically volunteers would sit on the trail and record whether or not they see pikas. It was run out of the Oregon Zoo's education department with some of their volunteer management staff running the volunteer parts. But this really changed in 2017 when, of course, the devastating Eagle Creek fire burned most of the pikas distribution in the Columbia River Gorge. And this is the point where the Pika Watch group really sprung into action in order to apply for funding to take the lead on monitoring the recovery of the pika population in the aftermath of this fire. And so together we set out to answer a few burning questions. Get it? Because it's about fire. I promise that's the first time I've made this joke. No, it's not. All right. Our first question was, we were trying to understand how the fire affected habitat quality for pikas. And then the next question we set out to understand was how the fire might have affected the distribution of pikas after the fire. Like, how were they able to recolonize this burned habitat? And then finally, kind of a meta question that we set out to answer as well was how to best engage volunteers in this kind of monitoring. And this is really important both as a way of sustaining long-term interest in this project and in collecting really quality post-fire monitoring data and making sure that the data that our volunteers are collecting are really useful and applicable to conservation and management. So in 2018 and 2019, we were really fortunate to receive a 3-year grant from the U.S. Forest Service to train volunteers and in these transect surveys, which involved walking lines across the talus and searching for pika sign in the rocks. And I noticed on the attendee list that some of you folks that are here tonight have participated in this in the past. So thank you. We really appreciated your efforts on this. And then volunteers also helped us survey the vegetation resources that were available to pikas at each site. And then some volunteers also helped us with replacing temperature sensors that we had out there before the fire. We were really fortunate to gain some special access to closed areas of the gorge, but these were pretty intensive surveys. And so we also continued those sitting surveys because they were a little bit more inclusive for any volunteers who didn't have the time or didn't feel comfortable walking across the talus. And in the sitting surveys, basically volunteers just stay on the trails, watch and listen for pikas, but don't necessarily have to move around on the rocks. They can move around on the trail, but they don't have to leave the trail. However, the sitting surveys during this time were still limited to the open areas of the gorge, which, as you may likely remember, were still pretty restricted in 2018 and 2019. Like zoos across the country, the Oregon Zoo was hit really hard by the pandemic, but last year, largely as the result of efforts from Carrie, our volunteer coordinator, and the zoo's conservation manager, Shervin Hess, we were able to bring this project back in full force. And we trained over 400 volunteers last summer between our in-person and virtual trainings. And these volunteers conducted 477 sitting surveys, awesome work, at 76 of our core sites. So that was every single one of our core monitoring sites got visited at least once. And last year we chose not to bring back those transect surveys, but we still got a ton of great data that I'm really excited to share with you today. So the first thing I wanted to share with you is a few results about how the fire affected the habitat quality for pikas. And I'll start by showing you how the habitat looked different after the fire. So if we return to the that site that I've been showing you pictures of before, here on the left, you can see this site. This is one where I had done diet and temperature recordings for my PhD, was changed after the fire in 2018. And you can see that basically there was a lot of moss cover that burned at this site, as was the canopy cover in many places. And so based on this image, it will surprise nobody that the aerial extent of that moss cover was significantly reduced. So here you're looking at the average moss coverage at 30 different sites where we had moss coverage data from before the fire and that our transect volunteers visited in 2018 and 2019. And you can see that less than half of the moss cover remained on average in the 2 years following the fire. When it came to temperature sensor data, what I can also tell you is that some of my surface temperature sensors didn't survive, which indicates that the temperature at these sites was at least the melting point of this plastic. There were other sensors that I had that literally exploded. I spent several hours at this site actually trying to pick up tiny bits of microprocessors out of the rubble. And I don't know what I was, why I did that. I think I was thinking that hopefully maybe OnSet would be able to like put this back together and somehow get my data, but that was clearly like not gonna happen. However, if we return back to this site where this is actually literally in the talus right here where this sensor melted and looked just like this, luckily my sensor that was down in the talus was not melted or exploded and actually appeared to be functioning totally normally when I recovered it. So we did actually end up measuring temperatures in the talus during the Eagle Creek fire. Now, we know that the fire arrived at this site in the evening of September 14th, and while my surface sensor was melting and, you know, 200 meters away, the other sensor was exploding in that evening, we did see a sharp increase in temperature to a whopping 7.5 degrees Celsius, which is still about 45 degrees Fahrenheit. I actually was able to recover my talus sensors at two other sites, and each one where the moss cover and the surface sensor burned or exploded, respectively, the talus temperatures maybe ticked up just a couple degrees, but actually stayed remarkably cool. And this is like kind of amazing when you think about it, right? Those sensors are not actually that far apart in space, but the insulative capacity of these rocks and that cool, stable microclimate was able to maintain a totally habitable conditions for pikas, even during this raging fire at the surface. And this is actually in sharp contrast to the time that I measured temperatures in the talus during a fire on Mount Hood in 2011, which some of you guys may remember the Dollar Lake fire. And the temperatures in the talus during that fire were actually pushing 20 degrees Celsius and the surface sensor didn't melt. So I want to share with you one more bit of data about the Eagle Creek fire. Since I now actually have over 13 years of temperature data with a minor interruption from the fire melting and exploding sensors, I decided to see if the fire had altered microclimates relevant to pikas at this site and whether those microclimates may have recovered in the 6 years that have passed since the fire. So at the site that you're looking at in this picture, I calculated the average August temperature at the surface of the talus and then about 1 meter below the surface, as well as the ambient temperatures that we would experience here on the surface. So here what you're looking at is a plot of average temperature in August at this site. These black dots are basically the ambient temperatures. So these are the ones that we would experience, sort of the average temperature that we would experience walking around. The red dots represent the average temperature in August at the surface of the talus that pikas basically would experience when they're active on the rock slide. And the blue dots represent the average temperature measured 2 to 3 feet below the which would be the pika's refuge. Now, I began recording data at this site in 2011, and I've maintained sensors in these three locations since then. And it's a little bit hard to see from this graph, but there actually has been a significant increase, an increasing trend in ambient temperatures since the beginning of this study. And actually, the average August temperature has risen at this site by about 2.5 degrees Celsius since 2011. So that is a different story, but I think an important note. And one thing you'll notice here is that before the fire, the surface and the talus temperatures aren't really correlated with the ambient temperatures, which is to say that they aren't warmer in warm years, and there's no really directional trend before the fire. Now, we know that the fire, burned this site in September of 2017. And I do have data from August of that year for the talus and for the ambient sensor, but not for the surface sensor because that was one of the ones that melted. And we can then look at the range of temperatures of the surface temperature and the ambient temperature from before the fire for these pika relevant microclimates. And what we can see here is that the surface temperatures ranged from about 9 to 14 degrees Celsius, and the talus temperatures were between about 4 and 7 degrees Celsius. Now, there's a lot of variability here, probably due to how much precipitation we get during this month. But when we look at what happened following the fire, we can see that the talus temperatures are basically within this range of temperatures that we saw from before the fire. And I had 2 years, unfortunately, of data failure or loss here. But the surface temperatures are actually elevated by about 4 degrees Celsius from the range of what we saw before. Now, note that the ambient temperature is actually cooler in the 4 years following the fire. So this isn't simply driven by warmer summer temperatures in those years. More likely, it's because of that loss of moss cover and the loss of canopy cover. And we saw the same pattern at a second site that had similar high moss cover and severe burn, where the surface sensor exploded. And we see these warmer surface temperatures in the 6 years following the fire. What I think is also really interesting about this, though, is actually looking at what happened this past year. So you can see here that in 2023, this is the elevation. And in 2023, actually, we had the surface sensor actually returned to being in this kind of pre-fire normal. And I'm not sure if that's just because of a change in like the specific placement, or if it has to do with the recovery of the moss cover, or if it was just a cool rainy August in 2023 or what, but it'll be really exciting to see if this trend continues next year. Okay, so given these changes in moss cover and temperatures, we then turn to our volunteer data to find out how pika occupancy and distribution may have changed after the fire. And we ended up with 31 different sites where we had reliable data from pika occupancy surveys from before the fire and which volunteers surveyed afterwards in both 2018 and in 2023. And what we found here is that before the fire in the surveys 2013 to 2015, there was about 81% occupied sites at these 31 sites. And our volunteers, unfortunately, not surprisingly, found pikas at a lot fewer sites right after the fire. So we basically lost pikas at about 10 different sites, which is about a third of the places that they used to be from before the fire to the year immediately following the fire. But by now it's been nearly 4 years since the fire. And so I want to show you how this site has changed since then. And it seems that the green growth is really returning to some of these sites. And although the moss cover will be very slow to come back, there now are actually many, many more grasses and forbs than what we saw at this site from before the fire, and perhaps even stimulated by the fire itself. And along with the vegetation, of course, as the title of our talk kind of gives away, it seems that the pika populations may also be recovering. So this year, our volunteers found the most pikas ever since before the fire. We're actually very close to pre-fire levels. We also found 3 sites that were occupied this season for the first time since the fire, and an overall occupancy rate across all of our sites of about 80%. So the 74% is just at these 31 sites where we have data for every single season of sampling. Our volunteers are not conducting abundance surveys or any formal vegetation surveys anymore, so we aren't estimating moss cover, but they are still collecting photographs of the site, and these can also be really useful in terms of a way of the volunteer observations are helping us to document the vegetation recovery. This is just one example of a site that we call CPW21, but there will be a lot more as we start kind of filtering through these data. All right, our last research question that we really set out to answer here was trying to understand a little bit more of kind of a meta question about how to best engage volunteers in monitoring pikas. And one of the first steps here has been really trying to compare accuracy. But in order to understand like the accuracy of these surveys, you have to have something of sort of a gold standard. And so for that, we actually turned to one of my collaborators, Eric Beaver. This is a picture of Eric photobombing one of my camera traps during my PhD. He's a very serious scientist, but a very goofy dude too. And he has been really interested in the distribution of pikas in the gorge, and in 2019 actually had permits to go and do his own transect surveys in the like across closed areas of the gorge as well. And so we were able to actually use his surveys essentially as like a gold standard for whether pikas were truly at or probably not at a site. And so we then set out to try to calculate the sensitivity and the specificity as ways of understanding the accuracy of our volunteer surveys. And so the sensitivity, when you think about sensitivity, this is the probability of detecting pikas if they're truly there. So you can think about this as like a detectability. Sometimes I think it's become a little bit easier to think about this in terms of COVID tests. So a sensitivity of a COVID test would be if you have COVID, what's the probability that you'll test positive? And this is really thinking about avoiding false negatives. Now, specificity is really the probability that a site that a volunteer reports as occupied is actually occupied. And so if you think about this again as like a positive COVID test, it's what's the probability that you actually have COVID if you test positive for it in terms of avoiding false negatives. Except I think that obviously we can all agree that a positive COVID test is a bad thing and a pika occupied site is a good thing. So when we actually compared our site at our volunteer surveys to Eric's surveys, what we found is that the specificity in both types of surveys was really, really high, like over 90%. And so what that means is that when volunteers say that they found a pika, they most likely really did find a pika. But when we look at the sensitivity, we find that the sensitivity is higher in the transect survey, which means that volunteers were less likely to miss the pikas in the transect survey, more likely to miss them in the sitting survey. And this is not really that surprising because they're longer and more intensive surveys and people are moving around on the talus. So they might be more likely to elicit a pika call. So again, we find that false positive observations are very rare, but false negative observations are a little bit more common. And the next thing that we were interested in doing was trying to understand like the conditions under which people might be more likely to miss pikas, because that's really what will help us to refine our protocols. And the single best predictor, it turns out, of when volunteers missed pikas was at sites with a really low pika density. So let me explain this graph for you. Your y-axis here, you're seeing basically the proportion of visits to a site where volunteers missed pikas. So this would be a site where 100% of the volunteer surveys missed pikas, but the professional surveyors found them. And then at 0%, this would be the sites where volunteers found pikas at 100% of the different surveys that truly had pikas. So each of these spots represents a site that was truly occupied. The blue dots are volunteers doing transect surveys, and the orange dots are volunteers doing sitting surveys. And so you can see, again, overall, the transect surveys are lower here. There's a lot more zeros here, meaning that the transect surveys were a little bit more sensitive and less likely to accidentally miss the pika. But when there were fewer than about one pika per transect, so this x-axis is the density of pikas in terms of the number of individuals that were detected per unit of search effort. And when we get this number gets below about one or so, it was often really easy for volunteers to miss the pikas. And this could be for a lot of reasons. One could be that at these sites of low pika density could also be the hotter and drier sites, which means that the pikas may be more active at dawn and dusk and less active during daylight hours when our volunteers are doing surveys. In addition, pikas use these calls in sort of social contexts, so they may be less likely to call at really low densities because they're just not really going to talk to themselves. And so that may decrease their sort of detectability or the probability of finding them. And then some of these sites are also just huge, like think football field or bigger. But pikas maybe live in just a very small area. So it could also be very dependent on where exactly the volunteers happened to survey as to whether there were pikas in that area to detect. But I think that this highlights the importance of having multiple surveys at some of these really low density sites as a way of being able to detect these changes in the future. Because remember that if basically anybody detects a pika at a site, it's almost certainly is occupied based on our specificity analysis. The other thing that we found is that seemed to really help was playing a recorded pika call. So pikas are actually really likely to call back when you play a call. They don't do it as well when we try to imitate calls. So it's really fun. And even if you're like a professional pika call imitator, like I am, after decades of practicing my pika call imitation, they can tell the difference and give you the cold shoulder. But they do actually often respond when you play a recording of a real pika call. And this is something that we're going to be implementing as sort of a requirement and also tracking a little bit more carefully in our upcoming 2024 season. The last result that I want to share with you is also that we gathered some evidence that longer surveys are likely to be a little bit more accurate. And so this year we actually are extending the length of time that we ask volunteers to survey from 20 minutes to 25 minutes before leaving and calling a site unoccupied. And this is based on some of the evidence that we found from this past year. So let me walk you through this chart. It's a little bit hard to follow. Y-axis here is the survey duration in minutes, and these blue bars are sites where volunteers reported no pikas. So this blue bar here represents the average length of time where volunteers reported no pikas, but it was a true negative. So they no pikas were detected and they truly weren't there. And what you can see is that the volunteers who missed the pikas, these are the false negative surveys, were on average spent about 3 minutes less at the site than those who reported a true negative. The red surveys then are places where volunteers are seeing pikas. So these are our true positive detections where volunteers saw a pika and it was truly a pika. And these, this bar represents our false positive observations. And what we can see here again is that these are sites that experts found to be unoccupied, but somebody reported a pika sighting that we couldn't verify with a sound or a picture. And again, we see that the true positives are a little bit longer surveys than the false positive. So the difference here is a little bit subtle, but it I think really to me suggests that it may really be worth it to spend an extra few minutes in terms of having a fairly big impact on the accuracy of these surveys. Okay, so just to sort of wrap up what I've just told you about, our first finding was that the fire really reduced the moss cover and potentially increased the talus temperatures, at least for the first 4 or 5 years following the fire. We'll see what happens if that those surface temperatures in the next couple of years. It'll be very, very interesting to see. However, these habitat quality changes probably also had a strong effect on the distribution of pikas. We found a sharp decrease in pika occupancy in the year immediately following the fire, but then a rebound in the following years. And within 6 years of the fire where we are now, we actually seem to have a much better handle on and occupancy rates that are much closer to the pre-fire distribution. And then finally, what we found is some, I think, really interesting and very valuable data on guidelines for this kind of participatory science project. I think that our data in this respect really highlight the importance of having multiple visits, again, especially at those really low density sites. And this will be even more important, as Carrie is going to tell you about, because we hope to involve volunteers in the following year in monitoring populations that could be potentially experiencing declines on the range edges. This year, we also will be including call playbacks as a recommendation and then tracking their use in data submission, as well as updating our recommendation for how long volunteers should stay at each site before moving on if they haven't heard anything. So with that, I'm going to turn the stage over to Carrie, who is going to tell you a little bit more about getting involved and the work that we're going to be doing in the coming year.
Hey, thanks, Joe. Appreciate that. So you're wondering how to get involved at this point. Some of you already know this, but we do offer in-person trainings each year. And starting last year, we offered virtual trainings as well. And that's just been really great to allow access for a lot of people who might not have it otherwise, or they just can't get to Portland. One thing we also started last year that we're continuing this year is an in-person training in white salmon at the community library there. So there's three opportunities here for in-person trainings if you'd like to get involved and join us. Space is limited, and you might have seen those flying across your social media yesterday when the zoo did their big push. But there's also the online training, and basically that has unlimited capacity. For those of you who've already done the training as recently as last year, we also have a kind of refresher course that we're offering this year for you so that you don't have to go through all of the training once again. But there's a QR code here if you want to sign up. All right. Okay, and so why would you want to come to an in-person? You get to meet project leadership, of course, but the training includes details about identifying pikas, survey protocols, and how to sign up and how to navigate to the sites, as well as kind of safety procedures. It's basically, if you can hike, you can be out on these trails surveying for pikas. We even have some drive up, and this year I've added lists for sites that you can cycle to along the historic trail, the paved bike path, and then you can also drive up to a few different ones down in Mount Hood National Forest, as well as along the gorge. And then another reason, besides just meeting us, because we are amazing people, obviously, you can eat snacks and hang out with us. Joe's in agreement that we're amazing. So yeah, come in to one of these meetings and you can see us too. So this is a look at the virtual training that we have. Just so you're aware, this is all the same material as what you would get in the in-person training. You're not interacting with a person per se in this, but all of us are teachers in these events, and we also answer questions as we see them. What's really nice about the virtual training is it's just completely at your own speed. It's self-paced, asynchronous. It includes YouTube videos that Joe produced a few years ago and has updated since then to, you know, basically reflect the current standards in the gorge. And it also includes a volunteer manual, so you'll have everything you need once you've completed training. And you can always refer back to this information if you need to. So what do you receive if you complete the training? So we've got this super special page of survey links. It's pretty much everything you need to complete a survey. And it tells you how to do it. It tells you, you know, where to do it in this spreadsheet down below. What the numbers are, and there's a map that shows where the sites are located. Each site has turn-by-turn walking directions, mostly generated through Google, and we also let you know, you know, hey, if you're trying to do the sites near Multnomah Falls, you're going to need a permit, and so to be aware of that. We try to provide all that information, as well as which sites are accessible via the bus system through the gorge. We're trying to make the program as accessible as possible. It's important to all of us. But this spreadsheet down here at the bottom, That basically represents, a snapshot in time of some of the sites that were surveyed in the gorge or on Mount Hood. And so what you see here is, was it surveyed? Yes, number of surveys at that site, and then the date of the last survey. And then there's also this issues reported field here. So basically, all of you are probably aware that the Boulder Lake fire happened last year. Well, we have a site out there, and just before you would have been able to get to that site, it burned. And so I went in and I noted, okay, there's an issue. You can't reach the site. Don't bother going out there. We provide as up-to-date information as possible so that you are not wasting your time going out there. But there's also kind of a wide disparity as far as, which sites get visited a lot. It's very important for us to try to visit all of the sites as much as possible. That being said, if you just really like, the sites at Beacon Rock, then you can do those sites too. Like we're okay with that. We want you to have fun. And if you do some surveys for us along the way, that's perfectly fine. But the most important thing is that, if you go out and survey, even if you don't see a pika or hear one, we still would like you to submit that survey form, because no pikas is data and pikas is data. Like, we need to know whether or not you saw or heard them. And if you could take photos to prove that you saw them, or videos, that's even better. So most important thing is that, when you go out there, that you let us know that you were there by doing the survey. So as Joe alluded to a little bit ago, this map kind of represents like the distributional edges of the pika range in the gorge. And why that's important is because if the range is changing, if those edges are, kind of creeping inward, that is something that we would like to know. So with that being said, we'll be adding a handful of new sites in the circled areas shown, to be able to help monitor if the distribution is changing, especially given the concerning trends of warming temperatures in the Columbia River Gorge that Joe is finding with her temperature data loggers. And we'll be taking a closer look at some of these edge sites where we have historical data from both Joe and Eric Beaver to sense if there are going to be any changes in the distribution of pikas in the gorge. We're likely to see them first at these edge sites. Okay, so Pika Patrol is a recent addition to our arsenal, for lack of a better phrase. So this is a smartphone app that anybody can use. In fact, we recommend that every one of our volunteers also has this app. A great example is I hiked along the PCT in Herman Creek last year. We surveyed 8 sites that same day, but there were 3 other sites that we heard pikas at. And that's very interesting and valuable information to know. So we submitted Pika Patrol sightings through that. It allows you to, it takes your GPS coordinates, it automatically detects your elevation, and then you just enter information about whether or not you saw or heard pikas. You can add audio files, and then how many pikas you think you detected. And the more people who use this, the more feedback we can continue to give to our partners, all of whom are listed here at the bottom: Colorado Pika Project, the Denver Zoo, Colorado, or Rocky Mountain Wild, and then If Then. There's a QR code here, again, if you'd like to download that app and participate that way as well, or if you don't want to go through the training and want to just use Pika Patrol app, all data is good data for us. And this is a map showing where the various sightings or hearings of pikas came in through the app last year. So you can kind of see the cluster down here in Colorado, where people on the Pika Project are using it there. And then along the Cascades here in the Northwest, and a few outliers in other areas where we know the American pika lives. And this data is very interesting and helpful for us as well. So we would love to expand this. Basically, anywhere, if you're out and about and you hear a pika or you see one, please use the app to submit that so that we can chart where they're at.
Okay. All right. And so that's, I think, mostly what we have to say. So just wanted to remind everybody that science is a team sport. There are more people that have been a part of this research than we could possibly fit on one slide. But in particular, again, wanted to give a shout out to Shervin and Amanda, who really helped to administer this program. And Shervin in particular really helped to revitalize it and bring it back this past year. And especially all of the really amazing pika volunteers with whom we've had the pleasure of working, and the Oregon Zoo for supporting this project. So thank you also to all of you, dear humans, for coming to our talk. And I think that we have a little bit of time for answering questions.
Thank you guys both so much for taking the time to make those presentations. They were lovely. We are now moving into the Q&A portion of the evening. Please put your questions in the question box. We will try to get to as many as possible tonight. We'll go till right about 7:30 before ending the webinar for the evening. Without further ado, we have our first question. And that is from Natalie. I heard today in a PSU class that Colorado pika are the happiest. How was this determined?
Well, that's news to me, but I think it is a really good question. And actually, there are a lot of people who are really interested in this idea of animal welfare and basically trying to define that as sort of like the subjective experience of well-being. And it's really a gnarly thing to measure because, you know, obviously, once AI systems get big, good enough that I can like ask pikas how they're feeling and then they can respond and I can understand what they say, like my life is going to be so much easier. but it's really hard to measure that kind of welfare. So I don't know that anybody has ever like done a study that has conclusively demonstrated that Colorado pikas are the happiest. But I think that they are definitely like more widespread in Colorado. We're not seeing the same kinds of declines in Colorado as we are seeing in places like the Great Basin and some other like sort of super isolated mountain ranges. And so the species as a whole, you know, in Colorado is doing, you know, relatively well. There probably is because they have a larger amount of connected high elevation habitat compared to some of these other places in their range.
Awesome, thank you. We have a volunteer who wants to know if they have the app from last year, does the app need to be updated going into this season?
I think that your app should automatically update unless you have auto updates turned off. And if you are in that case, you should update it mostly just because there have been some like user fixes to the app and it's now available in Spanish, which, you know, Carrie had on a slide that is kind of an also a neat, you know, accessibility feature. So you should update the app, but it doesn't have to be updated. The old versions will still work.
How loud are their calls and how close would you have to be to hear a pika?
Carrie, you want to take that one?
Yeah, you know, it kind of depends on the size of the field, honestly. I mean, I've heard them from like, I'd estimate 100 plus feet away, but it can, sometimes they sound a lot more tinny also, and I'm not sure why that is, if they're just like in the middle of some rocks and calling back when I'm playing my long call video. But yeah, I mean, you don't, if you're out in the gorge and, you know, you're right along 84, it might be a little harder to hear them, but I've heard them there from, you know, 75 feet away. So again, that's maybe a subjective thing too, but if you're listening, you should be able to hear them. And if you've got a dog with you, they may let you know that they're there before you're expecting to see them, so.
Thank you. How did the populations of pika in Mount Hood and the Columbia Gorge become separate from one another?
That's a really good question. And the short answer is we're not entirely sure. but it seems like the elevations sort of at the middle range of elevations, so in the sort of like 3 to 4,000 feet elevation, or two to four, or actually like from a habitat perspective, those seem to be like the most thermally stressful elevations. So in the Columbia Gorge, you have these really unique features, including like the moss cover and the like steep walls of the gorge and these like potential rock ice features happening below the talus that are providing these good microclimates for the pikas. And then on Mount Hood, you have this like more typical mountain habitat that's characterized by cooler temperatures. But in that middle range of elevations is the place where it seems to be the most stressful. And there are pikas at some of those middle elevation sites, but I think that like those populations really kind of became separate because those middle elevations are not as passable.
Thank you. What are pika eating in areas where moss was destroyed?
Yeah, we don't know the answer for that for sure because we haven't sat and watched them, or, you know, sometimes you can collect scat and then sequence plant DNA out of the scat to be able to see what they were eating. But in general, pikas are what we call generalist herbivores, which just means that they can eat a little bit of anything, but they usually don't specialize on anything, except of course for the moss. So in the places where the moss cover was really burned, my suspicion is that they were sort of eating whatever they could, whatever was there, you know, but at some of those sites, it seems like at least in the years following the fire, there was a lot of like fresh, you know, grasses and wildfires that may have actually been kind of stimulated by the fire and the nutrients that are redeposited into the soil. So it does seem like in some cases it may be that there are, you know, actually a lot of more nutritious food that's available following the fire than there was before.
Thank you. And have sites on the Washington side that weren't burned by the fire been researched much? Sharon was wondering more particularly about Cape Horn, since there's a lot of talus slopes in that area.
Might pass this one to Carrie.
So Cape Horn is actually, that area is a couple of our edge sites that we're looking into adding this season. And it wasn't burned, but one thing to keep in mind is, you know, people think of usually Oregon for, you know, waterfalls, right? And then the Washington side is more, you know, wildflowers. And that's because those south-facing slopes get a lot of sun, which that means there may not be as many pikas because it's getting fairly hot on those rocks as well. So we are trying to expand the number of sites that we have in you know, Southwest Washington along the gorge. That's in progress, and Cape Horn is part of that as well. So I can say that I have never heard or seen a pika at Cape Horn. It's not to say that they're not there, but we'll find out for sure, hopefully, this upcoming season.
Thank you. What time of the day are pika most active?
You want to take that one?
Yeah, I'll take this one. Joe knows that I am not a morning person, so in order to get out and see the pikas, you've got to be out there pretty early. We definitely had much more success this past season at, you know, heading out at dark 30 to hike up to some sites. Basically, you know, just around 7 a.m., I would say, is probably, if you're arriving at the site around 7 a.m., is probably your best opportunity. And if, like me, you're not a morning person, then you can choose the sites that you don't have much of a hike from the parking lot. But earlier is better. We've actually been there and awake before the pikas were, and thought that we were in, you know, not going to see any. So yeah, earlier is better, though. You might, in some of the areas that are in shade, like there's one off Dry Creek Road that basically feeds up to Dry Creek Falls, and there's a site there, and almost every time I've gone in the kind of early evening, like 5 to 6 to 7 p.m. time range, I always hear and see pikas there. So it kind of depends on, you know, when are those areas in shade. But going in the morning, they're crepuscular, so going in the morning is going to be your best bet, always.
Thank you. Johanna, will you please demonstrate your fake pika call?
Yes, I'm happy to. So pro tip from the pro, it's better if you plug your nose. It like makes a better quality of piping call. So it's like.
That was perfect.
Pikas actually have dialects. So in some places they like across their range, like the Colorado pikas sound different than the Oregon pikas, which sound different than pikas in like the Sierras. They just have slightly different pitch of calls. So there's a one of the study sites that I work at in Utah, the pikas actually have kind of a two-tone call. So it's like.
Do pikas reside in Olympic National Park? If not currently, did they ever?
Yeah, that's actually a really interesting question because Olympic National Park is like super prime, awesome habitat for pikas and they aren't there. And as far as we know, they've never been there. So I don't know why that is. I think they just happened never to get there and then they never got there. And that's our best guess, but it has definitely been a really interesting, it's an interesting notable absence.
Thank you. Are there sites on the Timberline Trail for pika?
Yes, there are lots of sites on the Timberline Trail. And I think that some of our monitoring sites are along the Timberline Trail, right, Carrie?
Yeah, on the north side. On the south side, like from Timberline, probably your best bet there is going to be Rushing Water Creek, which is end up into Paradise Park. Is where I've seen them on that side. So maybe 5-6 miles or so from Timberline Lodge on the south side.
Yeah, but basically if you're hiking the Timberline Trail and you come to a big pile of rocks, you should stop and listen and look. Yeah.
Will there be another effort to petition the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service to list pika as federally threatened due to climate change?
I don't know the answer to that question. The reason that that effort was ultimately declined is that they're like, it just seems like the pika response to climate change is really variable across their range. So what is happening, you know, there definitely are some populations where we're seeing these really steep declines, but there are a lot of other populations that seem to be doing really well. And, you know, like our data in the Columbia River Gorge suggests that that population is like, you know, has rebounded, you know, pretty impressively. And so as a, like at the species level, I think that there isn't enough evidence right now to warrant that kind of listing yet. That may change and it may be that like different, like subspecies are, you know, differently vulnerable. But I actually think that that variability makes pikas, you know, more interesting as opposed to less interesting, because I think that there's just a lot of really cool questions to be asked about sort of both how are they doing in different parts and why are they doing differently in different parts of their range. So I don't know if there will be another effort. I doubt that another effort will be successful in the short term, but we will see.
Thank you. Johanna, what research is next for pika in the gorge for you or for other researchers?
Yeah, as Carrie mentioned in the end of the talk, we're really interested in sort of monitoring these distributional edges. And that's an area that we're really hoping to be able to involve volunteers in the future. And that just because like the population seems to have done really well in, you know, rebounding from the fire, but we're looking kind of at these range core sites. And if there is going to be distributional change in the gorge, you know, you would see it first out there at the edges between where pikas are found and where they're not found. So that's definitely a big area of focus. I know that there are some folks that are, you know, Eric and I are collaborating with to potentially try to collect some scat samples and have some population genetics work done to be able to look at kind of how, you know, the genetically related and look at gene flow between populations and things like that. And also if we collect scat, we are also hoping to potentially look at stress. So you can measure stress hormones in the scat and you can actually then try to understand like what kinds of habitat conditions lead to higher or lower levels of physiological stress in pikas. And that could be kind of like a early warning indicator of sites that might be, you know, more kind of on the edge, as opposed to sites that have really good core habitat. And hopefully that can kind of point us towards conservation and management as well.
Perfect. Thank you. Well, Carrie, what is your most memorable experience when you volunteered with Pika Watch before running the program?
Ooh, that's a good question. probably the reason it was top of mind was Rushing Water Creek. I mean, besides like the story that you told for my bio, we were backpacking Paradise Park, and we heard and saw some pikas kind of hustling around, and we just watched them for a couple hours, you know, as the sun was setting, and just really, it was cool to see them because, you know, in the gorge, they can kind of afford to not be running around constantly collecting food because they have it readily available. But it's like the ones on Mount Hood have to hustle, and they're always moving. And so they were kind of, you know, hollering at us, I guess, to get off their lawn. And we just kind of sat and watched them. And that was just so much fun to just kind of be immersed in what they were doing, and just also amazing to see just how much they had to do just in that time we were there for a couple hours watching them. So it was pretty special.
Perfect. Thank you. What are their pikas predators as part of research? Sorry, I'm going to re-ask that. What are the top predators in the gorge for pika? And do you track predators as part of research?
Yeah. So definitely the most like successful predator of pikas is the weasels. And weasels are super successful at catching pikas because they can, like, first of all, they're like super mean, and they're super like muscly. They're like little like muscly electric sausage things, and they can like weave through the talus, and they are able to actually get pikas when they're down like in their safe hidey holes. So they are occasionally predated upon by like hawks, or, you know, larger things like a bobcat or a coyote or something like that. But weasels are definitely the most like effective predators. In terms of tracking predator density, that's not something that I have ever been doing on purpose. I have had an occasion to study this a couple of times, either through camera trap data, where we're trying to like get camera trap footage of pika foraging behavior at the hay pile, and then we can actually track predators. The other way that I've accidentally measured this is actually hysterical, was we were trying to, as part of my PhD, one of the like kind of hysterical things that we tried to do was to measure what are called operational temperatures, which is basically a measure of the temperature that the animal would experience that integrates like wind and shade and sun. And so the way we were doing this was we made these little copper, like sort of sphere things made that were about the size of a pika. And then we covered them in rabbit pelts that you can buy at like for fly fishing. And then we put a temperature data logger inside. And the idea was that then this would sort of have the sort of size and shape of a pika that would sort of integrate all of these different forms of heat transfer. But actually what we ended up measuring, I think, was actually predation pressure, because these things would get like kicked around, and they were like nibbled, and they were chewed on at some sites and not at others. And, you know, they had googly eyes, and we'd come back and their googly eyes were all like, you know, kind of messed up. So I never published any of that. I think there's a space for that somewhere in the, you know, in the annals of improbable research. But I've never actually on purpose monitor predator density, but a lot of people do that. So.
Thank you. Are pika found in countries other than the United States?
Yeah, so actually there are something like 30 something species of pikas worldwide. All of them but two live in Asia. So there are pikas in Japan, in Siberia, in China, in the Himalayas, in Nepal, India. Actually, there are some very interesting, unusual pikas that live in Mongolia, and they like build little piles of rocks, like little tiny pebbles that they use to like sort of shelter space under larger rocks. It's very, very fascinating. And over there, about half the species live in rock slides like ours do, and then the other half live actually in burrows in prairies, and they're ecologically very similar to prairie dogs. So they live communally, they dig burrows, and their burrows provide habitat for other species in the same way that prairie dogs do in the US. In North America, though, we have the American pika, which is the distribution map that I showed you that's in the Western United States and Southern Canada. And then there's a second species in Northern Canada and Alaska that's called the collared pika. And so it's thought that the collared pika and American pika came across the Bering Strait and, you know, or their ancestor did, and then differentiated into these two species that we have over here. So actually the majority of pika species are found not in the United States. We just have one. Well, two in Alaska.
Awesome. Thank you. Can you use the Pika Patrol app when you have no internet connection? If not, can you add the data at a later date?
Carrie, you want to take that one?
Yeah, I'll take that one. Yes, you can. It actually caches it locally, and it'll tell you that it's saved it locally. And then once you've got service, it will upload it. And that I kind of like that better, honestly, because then if, you know, I have some additional information I want to add after I've already hit submit, then I can do that before it's sent. So yeah, you don't have to have internet service. So long as you have, you know, GPS enabled, which I think on all modern smartphones, it should automatically be. So yeah, it's a good option, especially out in the middle of nowhere where there's no service.
And is there a recording of the pika call on the app?
Yes, there is. So the app also contains training materials. So if you've never seen or heard or identified a pika before, you can listen to a call, you can see pictures. It tells you about some of their behaviors and identifying their poop. We didn't even talk about poop tonight, but their poop is horrible too. And then for volunteers as well, for Cascades Pika Watch, we also provide you with access to a pika video and calls so that you can play those on your phone, download them to your phone, and then you can also show people because sometimes passerbys are like, what are you doing? And then you can be like, look at these cute animals that we're studying.
I had that happen the other day on Angel's Rest when I was playing the video. Some people hit the patch and then they're like, is it a pika? And I was like, well, we call it fake pika, but it's in our phone. And they're like, wow, that sounds really clear. I was like, yeah, it does. That's why they come out. But yeah, it's definitely a conversation starter when you play those.
Thank you. One of our attendees wants to know where they can get pika t-shirts and other pika swag.
The internet.
Yeah. Mine is from, let's see, this shirt is from Because Tees. I'm not sure where Joe got hers, but Because has quite a few options there that are really nice.
Mine was a gift, so I don't, but it says Mountain Attire on it, so it might be from Mountain Attire. But you should also go to the Colorado Pika Projects and Rocky Mountain Wilds Redbubble store. And they have some really beautiful pika art that you can get on whatever swag you want. I think that it's the Rocky Mountain Wild Redbubble store. And I actually have a pika dress that like you can get it all put on this fabric. And it's like, yeah. So there's tons of pika swag. If you just Google pika shirt, you'll find all kinds of options.
It'll probably come up with like Pika-ture as well, though. Just be prepared for that. So yeah, I was going to say Cafe Press has a few items too, like hats and mugs, but yeah, Redbubble is a good choice.
But before you ask, Pika-ture is a pika, so technically. I mean, he's like crossed with like a lightning bolt and like has a tail, which I think he gets from the lightning bolt. But
I mean, I've seen some move fast enough that the lightning bolt could actually play into it. So
yeah.
Especially when you're trying to photograph them as they're running across the rocks and they're the same color. So,
yeah.
Thank you. Linda wants to know if you could talk a little bit about melanistic or Lewistic pikas.
Yeah. So we have, for those of you guys who don't know, a melanistic is an individual that has both of these are mutations in the pigments that get laid down in your hair. And so a melanistic pika is one that is completely black, and a leucistic pika is one that is completely white. And there we have had some reports of melanistic and leucistic pikas from across their range. I don't know if there was one, at least one leucistic pika that was reported and photographed on Mount Hood a few years ago. There are mutations that occur just randomly. I've never seen a leucistic pika, but I was very fortunate to see a melanistic pika in Montana some number of years ago. And I just have to tell you, it was really crazy. Like, I knew where the pika was because my collaborators had told me about this, and I went there and I was like, I'm gonna go see this black pika. And then it was like, just came out, and it was just like completely black pika. And they nicknamed that one the Dark Lord. And he actually, like, they were able to trap him and collect some tissue samples for like genetic sequencing, and then of course release him. And he lived for like 3 or 4 years, which is pretty good for a pika. So yeah, there is coat color variation. The other thing that I think is very interesting and maybe more relevant to the gorge is that the pikas in the Columbia Gorge are actually a lot darker in color than they are in other parts of their range. So if you look at pictures of pikas in the gorge and compare them to like a Colorado pika picture that you might just Google, they're actually a lot darker. And I think that, you know, it makes sense that they might be a little bit darker since so much of the rocks are like basalt in the gorge, and sort of a darker rock color on average might provide some extra camouflage. But there's definitely a unique population with unique color there as well.
Thank you. How can you distinguish male and female pika?
Yeah, the short answer to that is that you can't reliably. And even like we have done some studies where we trap them and mark them or collect samples and then release them. And even with an animal in hand, it's very, very, very hard to tell. The reason is because they have a cloaca. So it's just a single opening where everything goes in and out, and all of their like reproductive bits are like up inside the cloaca. And the one thing that you can kind of infer is that the pikas make two different types of call. There's the short call and then the long call. And the long call is basically like a bunch of short calls. And I can imitate it if you need.
I can pull a video too.
Typically males make long calls and females don't. And we don't actually know what the function of the long call is. But it may be sort of a territorial thing. It may be like a mating thing. But later in the season, both males and females will sometimes make long calls. So it's kind of a rule of thumb is that if you hear a long call, it's probably a male, but it's not like for sure.
I got the call here. You guys want to listen?
Yeah. Oh, I don't think it's playing.
You don't hear it?
No. I think Zoom like filters out like background noise.
Oh no.
Yeah.
Maybe we can put it in the chat or something.
Yeah.
I can do that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
When do pika breed, and how many babies per litter do they have? And have either of you seen pika babies before?
Yes, we've seen pika babies, and they are really cute. The only thing cuter than a pika is a baby pika. And contrary, in spite of the fact that they're related to rabbits, they don't actually breed like rabbits. They typically only have two babies per litter, and they usually, in most sort of typical alpine habitats, they time the babies to be born when the snow is melted and there's food available for mom when she's nursing them, because that's like super energetically expensive. And so they time it so they mate under the snow, and then the babies are born sort of right around snow melt. And then it's really like tough to be a baby pika in a typical habitat, because basically you stay in the den for, you know, maybe a few weeks or a month, and then you go out and you've got a couple months where you can kind of hang out with mom in her territory. And then, you know, by about late August, mom starts kicking the babies out and is like, get out of here, get a job, you're done, go to college, I don't care. you have to leave home. And so I've actually seen like a mom pika, like grab a baby pika by the scruff and like throw it off of a rock. And so they get like actively chased out, and they have to go and set up their own territory. And then they also have to like build a hay pile for themselves in the remaining summer that exists. So it's pretty tough to be a baby pika, but they're really cute. And they're like more like gray colored, and they have a higher pitched squeak. So instead of like, it's like.
So cute. What small mammal is most misidentified as pika?
I think probably the most common misidentifications that we see, Carrie, you can weigh in on this too, but is where you just see like sort of a flash of something moving across the rocks and think, you know, you like hope maybe it's a pika. Golden-mantled ground squirrels on Mount Hood and Douglas squirrels in the gorge are oftentimes, you know, they're about the same size of a pika, but they have tails, and pikas don't have a visible tail. So that's kind of the best sort of telltale sign.
I was going to say the other one is Townsend's chipmunks. I've also seen, you know, a flash, and it was a chippy, and I thought it was going to be a pika, but it's another one that just kind of moves on the talus really quickly. And I sent a link to the YouTube video that Zach Hahn shares with us of a pika, and there's a long call in there. I don't know if you guys can play that or not, just to. Let's see. I don't think it'll play if I do it, but maybe Kenzie, if you played it, it might work.
I see this one.
It might have some ad at the beginning of the video. Sorry.
Let's see. Yeah, let's see. There's a 40-second ad, so I don't think we have time for the video. But if you guys want to go look at it, save the link for later to watch it. One last question for you guys. Is there any way that our attendees can connect with you after this webinar, social media, website, places they can come connect and talk with you guys later?
Yeah, for sure. So you can sign up for Pika Watch trainings if you're local, or sort of semi-local, you can do the online training. And the link for that is oregonzoo.org/pika. And you know, if you just Google Cascades Pika Watch, that will come up as well. If you want to connect with us personally, you can look up my email address. If you go to coloradomesa.edu, you can look me up, or I am on Instagram as Dr. Pika Joe, DocTorPikaJo. And, you can chat with me there or follow pictures of pikas and sometimes my dog.
You can also join the Cascades Pika Watch Facebook group. People post photos and videos there from all over the range here. And you can also, if you have any specific questions that we didn't get to answer, you can email cascadespikawatch@gmail.com. That's kind of our official email address. And I monitor that each day, so I'll get an answer. And if I don't have one, then I'll have Joe chime in with her answer. So.
Perfect. Thank you. And we'll be sending out an email after this webinar, sending some links with you all that we talked about in this webinar tonight. Thank you guys all again so much for watching and participating in this webinar. Those questions you wrote were amazing. And it was wonderful getting to know about pika in the gorge. Thank you so much again to our speakers for being here tonight and sharing their knowledge. Before you all go, I want to let you know that this webinar is a glimpse of many we are going to host throughout the upcoming year. If you enjoyed this webinar, consider donating to friends by scanning the QR code to help us fund our work. Your support means so much to us. We hope to see you at our upcoming webinar in July. Keep an eye out for emails and social media posts to learn more about future webinars and upcoming outings. A reminder that a recording of this webinar will be uploaded to our YouTube page tomorrow. Thank you all so much. Have a great night and a great start of spring.